My name is Siddharth. I work for Happiest Minds Technologies in Bangalore itself. And yeah, for today, you won't see the presentation here till the time the computer sets up. It will set up in a minute or so. Just give me that time. So the idea, what we are presenting today, is derived from a project that we did within Happiest Minds. We did a project for a digital marketing company. And that company gives a kind of assessment to a retailer or any company about their digital presence. So for example, let's say iPhone will come to them, Apple will come to them, or Apple being a very high-end example, I'll take a low-end example. Let's say MI comes to them and tells them that I want to understand how is my digital presence for one of the category of products. So what do you mean by digital presence? It means when somebody searches for a cell phone online, let's say I go to Flipkart or any of the websites or google.com, and I just type in, I want a 6GB phone with 6GB RAM or something like that. So when I type these keywords, 6GB RAM or some specific category of the space in it, at what page, at what time the MI phone comes up? Does it comes on the first page of Google, or does it come on the next page or the third page? So that is one part of it. One second, I'll have to shut down. Okay, I'll be standing there to make sure it starts up properly. So, yeah, so the idea here is for every retailer or for every customer, we give a kind of, what is their digital presence in terms of when you search something on Google or any other platform where they come. Then we go on all the retailer websites. For example, if you check Flipkart or Amazon, the presence for cell phones will be on these websites, as well as on their main portals. So for example, MI's own website, along with its competitors, let's say any other competitor, let's say Poco phone, Oppo, all their websites as well. So where does my piece comes into picture? My piece comes into picture when you actually drill down to the product descriptions which are available on all these websites. So if I talk about, let's say, iPhone, or it will have a product description on Apple's website, but the same product description might not be present on Amazon.com. And on Flipkart.com, you'll again have a separate product description, right? So there is the uniqueness is not there in all these product descriptions for the same product on multiple websites. So we want to understand what is the quality of that product description which is present on these websites, right? So how do you determine the quality of a product description? Right. So for example, if I take an example of a chocolate brand, right? Let's say Cadbury's. Cadbury's, you have seen the advertisements. They'll have some taglines like mouth-watering, delicious, tasty, yummiest, finger-licking good is a KFC. So all these taglines are actually nice to hear. When you think of a headline as finger-licking good, you feel like eating it. It's mouth-watering actually, right? So there are some keywords which are present in all these product descriptions which make them unique and which make them good enough for people to actually buy them, right? Another example could be, let's say you talk about a diaper brand, right? So if you're buying a diaper or any product for your child, you'll go to the website, let's say Pampers website, right? There if you're trying to buy a diapers pack, it will say, it will keep your child silky smooth, he'll be happy wearing the diaper, right? So silky smooth. So these are some of the keywords or benefits that they try to explain. They don't tell you the features. Features means it is, it contains, let's say, a bottle of Coke. It contains 500 ml of this. That is a feature, or it is made up of this. But a benefit is what you derive from the feature. That is a benefit, right? So along with that, there are some other areas where we can incorporate some keywords contextually as well as semantically in the product description that could actually improve the way a product description is written by copywriters, right? Now we are talking about product description. Why? Is it important? The most important thing for everybody is how the picture looks, right? We go to Myntra.com, we check the picture looks good, the model is good, it is fitting properly, it is of my size, that's all. So first thing, we check the picture. Next thing that I personally check is there any discount on it, right? The pricing matters. Third thing, which I will check normally whenever I'm buying clothes, is it made up of cotton or is it nylon or something else? So the third point for me more personally will be a product description. That will come third. And rest of the things will come later on, like reviews for me personally, right? So that is where it plays a role. For example, if there is if it's summertime and the shirt is not made up of cotton, I'll not end up buying it. So it will be one of the things which will make me either a buyer of the product or either I'll move to the other website to look out for another product, right? So definitely these things come into picture when you are buying something on these websites. Can you connect the HDMI cable?
Oh, yeah.
It's connected, but it's not showing there.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so for the session actually, I had, 1 second. So for the session actually, I had a presentation and the white paper as well, and there are some contents in terms of the code as well, which I have embedded in the presentation. I hope people will derive some insights from the code fragments also, which I have tried to embed within the presentation. Just give me some time to let it open. So let's talk about some other things which are important in the product description. So it's not only these two items. Then let's say if a product description claims that they are the best phone in the world, they are the best smartphone in the world, they cannot claim anything like that. Not in India, but outside India, if you look at US, in US there were some laws passed, I think in 2012 or 2015, because of which if you have to claim something or if you claim something on the website, you actually have to give some supporting to claim to empower that claim. If you say we are the best, then you have to give some tagline or something along with that as a proof to show that actually you are the best, right? So we broadly looked at 2-3 categories as of now. One was the benefits, right? And then one is if you're putting up a claim, then you should actually put something to add on to that claim. You cannot just blindly put a claim, right? And then we also talked about, let's say, what do you say? If we are talking about a diaper brand, which I gave the example earlier, you'll also talk about kids because the brand is for kids, right? So you'll talk about the person for which the product is made, right? So that also plays a key role. So that means you are trying to personalize the description towards the consumer or the buyer, because the buyer can be the mother and the consumer is the child. The child won't look at the advertisement, but ideally he is the actual user of the product. So these are the different areas where we are actually trying to understand how a product description is important. So the talk today is about understanding how can we extract this information from a product description and can give an insight as to how valid or how important is a product description and can it actually convert into a buyer experience or people will not like it because of some certain reasons which we will come across the presentation. Okay, so finally the presentation is up. Yeah. So we talked about why a product description is important, right? So why a product description is important? Because it should be something that can actually help the person understand, and also it should be something, if it's a brand related to something that we eat, it should feel like mouth-watering as soon as we see the advertisement. For example, this is a product description from a website of a hot sauce, and the product description contains some words that help us understand why it is so mouth-watery to even read this description. So there are some words like ripe, savory. These words are called as sensory words. These are the words that attract our senses. That's why all these brands, which are food brands, they always include these keywords, mouth-watery, delicious, tasty. That's why they include it, because we feel as if we are actually eating them, if the product description is really good, right? So then we spoke about the customer or the consumer or the user of the product, right? So if you see this, this is another product description which I have got from a website of Kids Twice, right? So see how they have incorporated some keywords to highlight that the user or the consumer of the product. So kids are the consumers and they have highlighted it in their product description. The sentences actually start from the kids, right? So For example, kids can relive the magic of Disney, right? So it's targeting them itself. Next, again, something to do with that attracts your senses, right? So anything that to do with eating, right? So this is an example of Hershey's, and it's from their website. It includes some keywords like sweet and rich. Then it's a shampoo brand, right? It's a shampoo brand, and it tells you the benefits, right? The third category, the benefits of the product as well. It tells you it gently cleanses and moisturizes. And this is a bad example from one of the websites. This is actually from Amazon. This is actually from Amazon India. And the smartphone, so the issues that we see here, they've used a keyword called as best, right? So they are saying, I deliver the best, it delivers the best service after sale. So how can you claim you deliver a best after sale service unless you really put some content to claim that on the advertisement, right? But they're not doing that. So this was a broad classification of what are the things that we are looking for in the anything at all to do with the product description on any of the websites, right? So now let's get into the technicalities. Like, how do we actually do that, right? So let's look at it one by one. Step one is customer centricity. The user or the consumer or the customer of the product, right? So we're trying to find out those people who are actually consumers of the product through some NLP techniques. Now, before we proceed, this is all unsupervised data. We don't have labels, right? Because if you go to a website, you will have to read it and then tag it. Is it something to do with, does this sentence has something to do with buyer? Does this sentence something to do with the senses, like mouth watery? So we have to manually tag it. So it's not a supervised problem in terms of NLP, right? So it's a pure unsupervised data set that we have. Okay. So this is the algorithm. You will not be able to see, so I'll switch in between this and the actual diagram from the white paper. So this is the algorithm that we made to actually, you can see this easily till the end. Okay. So this is the algorithm that we made to find out if some sentences in a product description actually are customer centric or not. Are they buyer focused or not? So rather than going this, I'll keep switching in between this and an example so that you can easily relate to this algorithm of or a flowchart, right? So the basis for this is primarily knowledge-based databases like WordNet as of now. In this release, we have achieved using WordNet itself. Along with that, we are using some syntactical parsing techniques, and which includes constituency parsing, dependency parsing, as well as something called as POS tagging. I mean, you all might be aware of POS tagging. But most of the people, because nowadays we are all so much into context-based NLP, we talk about BERT, we talk about ELMO, but we don't care to talk about what happens if the problem is really unsupervised. All the pre-trained models, can they work on domain-centric data? Let's say, pick up an example of BERT, or let's pick up an example of universal sentence encoder. Most of the people will relate to them because most of the articles on internet are about them, right? So because that's the next-gen thing that has come into picture. But they work if you have really a huge data set to train, or they have a pre-trained model, which is either trained on Wikipedia corpus, or maybe it's trained on some sensory data, or maybe it's related to SEMCORE or those databases which have like word sense disambiguation related words, right? So they're all pre-trained, or you'll have to train it. To train it, you need a lot of labeled data set, right? So now the idea comes in, because we don't have those kind of techniques available to us, because ours is unsupervised data, and it can be related to any domain, right? So the next day, a biotech company can come to me and can ask me, we have a presence on these 5 websites in US and UK. You tell me, what is my digital presence compared to my competitors, right? So it's very much domain-centric. So I cannot just pick up Wikipedia corpus, right? Unless it is very specific, like senses. Senses is very specific. There I can still pick up something to do with context or something to do with ELMO or BERT or Google Encoder, because this is very generic. But if I talk about personal, if I go to a biotech company, right, the scientists will be using the things from a biotech company or somebody who might not appear so much frequently on Wikipedia corpus, right? So that's the reason we cannot go for those techniques. Feel free to pitch in between whenever you feel like asking anything. I mean, we don't need to wait till the end. for you to ask anything. You feel free to interrupt me in between so that we can close it as and when we get any issues. And if you have any other issues for which I have to show you something more than the presentation, I have the code base with me. So after the presentation, I can actually figure out from the code what is actually happening for something which you want to see in detail, and I can actually help you out in that way. Right? I have my laptop, so I have the code base with me.
Quick question.
Yes.
Yes.
It's unsupervised as well as rule-based. Unsupervised, it's not only rule-based, because it is also dependent on your dependency parser and your constituency parser. But it is rule-based because we have added some rules, especially for sensory. We have added some rules for sensory. But apart from that, it is based on the techniques varying from dependency parser and constituency parser. Now, before we speak about these techniques, we should know what these techniques are, right? Constituency parser, dependency parser, what these are, right? We should know about that, unless we, before we even speak about it, right? So do you want to really get 5 minutes so that I can show you the techniques and then dig into the rest of the presentation, or do you want me to continue? Because it will contain at least next 15 slides will be about constituency parsing, dependency parsing, and knowledge-based databases. I mean, we all know WordNet, but sure. So I'll switch to Chrome. So I actually had set up all the Chrome tabs, but unfortunately it got closed. And I would need access to internet if somebody can help me out. Okay. So till the time somebody comes and helps me out to get the internet running, I'll try to get my hotspot on and try to get this connected. Okay, so before it shows up, let me explain to you something which I have already saved in my presentation. It might not be visible clearly, but I hope it might help you to understand till the time this website comes up, because my net might not be that great. Okay, so this website, right? Okay, it came up pretty fast actually. So this website, right? This is the backend for this is your Core NLP package. Stanford Core NLP is the background for this. And this visualization has been created by a company, Brat Visualization. So there's a package, NLTK everybody knows, right? And on the back end, you have multiple NLP libraries also. There's a parser called as Core NLP Parser, which we might not deal in daily basis, but for this, we'll be using that. It's a Java-based parser, and NLTK provides a wrapper, a Python wrapper on top of that to access that Java-based parser. And what this website does, this website is written on top of that parser, Java-based parser. So whatever we are trying to do programmatically, we can actually type that sentence here and we can actually see output directly. It's not made by me or my company. It's something which is available to everybody. So everybody can check it out. So the example which is already written there, I'm just going to run it for you. So the example which is here is quick brown fox jumped over the lazy dog. I think my hotspot works. It's okay, no problem. Or let me take an example from the presentation itself so that I can explain to you a bit better than the generic example. Okay. So this is a sentence from a product description which is for Horlicks, and I've tweaked the sentence a bit. I've added some few lines on top of that to explain my algorithm. But essentially the thing that I'm trying to explain to you here is the constituency parser and the dependency parser. So we'll go through that now. So the first thing everybody is aware, part of speech, right? Everybody knows POS. It will tell you adverbs, verbs, everything. Next, let's go down and see what is the next part. So next part is constituency parser output. So when you run this library in Python also or the Java-based parser, you'll get this kind of output in a binary tree format. So to use it, you'll have to flatten the tree and then use any of the outputs. So what it does, see, the sentence was, Indian mothers have long known that Horlicks helps fussy toddlers by providing nutrients that help in weight gain. So it tries to understand the structure of sentence and tries to tell us some more details about it. So what can I derive from this chart? Before telling you what can I derive from it, I'll tell you what is the subject of a sentence. A subject definition based on NLTK website is something which is a noun phrase and which is a neighbor to a verb phrase and which has a proper sentence defined by S on the top. So that's the definition of based on the NLTK website. So how do you see this? So you see this as converting the entire sentence into different verb phrases defined by VP and noun phrases defined by NP, right? Now, how am I using it? I am using it to derive the subject of the sentence. So how do I derive the subject of sentence? I go back to the NLTK's definition. Now, all this is coded, but I'm telling you what I've coded. We go to the noun phrase of the sentence. We find out if it has an adjacent verb phrase in the binary tree output after flattening it. And then we verify if it has a valid sentence S on the top. Right? That is what we verify. Now, speaking about this output specifically, it has multiple valid fragments which it can consider as sentences separately also. Right? So if you look, there is an S here. Right? So this means that this part of the entire sentence, it also considers as a valid separate part. So even if I forget about the rest of the part, I can still just read this part. Horlicks helps fussy toddlers by providing them. I don't need to add the first line, like Indian mothers are long known. That's an extra line. I don't need to add that, right? So that's what constituency parser does on a high level. You can very easily use it. The only problem that you'll face is flattening the binary tree so that you can use the output from it. The rest of the pieces are pretty simple. Challenge will be with respect to how you code it for flattening the tree and utilizing and comparing where does a verb phrase lies, where does a noun phrase lies. Along with that, you can see a lot of tags here, VBZ, NNP. I hope you're all aware of all these tags because they are copy-pasted from POS tagging. They're part of speech, right? They're part of speech. So noun phrase, and noun phrase has a plural noun on the bottom, which is Horlicks, right? So constituency parsing, is it clear to everybody? Or you want me to take the next step? We can? Okay. So we'll take the next step and we'll go to the dependency parsing, which is the next technique that I'll be using for rest of the presentation. So let me go to dependency parsing for the same sentence. So we'll use this, basic dependencies, because I have not used enhanced dependencies. And how you can get in-depth about it, just search on internet, Stanford dependency manual. And you'll get a proper PDF explaining you in depth about each and every tag. What does it mean and how it does what it does, right? So what is dependency parsing? If you look at this output, this is a bit small. Everybody can see on the back or no? I'll zoom it. Everybody can see on the back? Zoom it, okay. Okay. So now, back side, clear, right? Okay. So see now, constituency parser gave me a high level output. It told me noun phrases, verb phrases, and it went in down from there, right? Now what did this sentence and this dependency parsing told me? This told me how each and everything is related to every other word. So if you were to derive the subject of the sentence from here, how would you derive that? There's a keyword called as N subject. This is not the only keyword. There could be multiple kinds of subjects that are given in the Stanford manual, which are defined by N subject, C subject. I don't know the definitions of all of them, but I have incorporated all of them by reading through the manual in my code. Right? So we derive the relations from this. So we derive the relation. For example, for my piece of code, I am primarily looking at the subject for the first categorization, which is, the personalization or the customer centricity. So for that, I'm looking at subject, not only N subject, C subject, there are multiple categories of subjects based on the manual. And then I'm finding out what it is related to. So it is related to mothers, right? And mothers is related to Indian, right? So this is a way to find out. But I don't go beyond this. I just look at N subject and I found out the dependency, which is mothers. So that is what I'm doing with the dependency parser. So it tells me the relationship between multiple words, right? That's what it is trying to do, right? So do you think we should go ahead to the next, or you want me to take some more example? I have some more examples during the PPT also. We'll move on? Okay. So these are the two techniques that I'll be using for the first categorization. So let me go back and explain to you the first categorization. Okay. So what is the algorithm actually states? So I'll be removing the presentation mode so that I can easily switch between this and the white paper. Yeah. So this is a happy flow. So for me, there is a product description on Horlicks. It has a sentence called as Indian mothers have long known for something, something, something. Now what does my algorithm does? It tries to find out the subject phrase contenders. Now, can you tell me what was the technique that we use for subject phrases? I have not mentioned it here. Anybody? We all had lunch. Let me. Sorry? Yes, constituency parser. Thank you. So that is a technique that I'm using here. Now, I don't say identify subject phrase. I say identify subject phrase contenders. So it means constituency parsing doesn't tell me the subject of sentence. It tells me contenders. So there can be multiple, right? So the sentence that I took is a straightforward sentence. Mothers are long known, something like that. There could be complex sentences. For example, I have come to Bangalore for this session and my friend has gone to Hyderabad for the same session. So here there are two subjects, I and my friend, means Siddharth and my friend, right? These are the two subjects. So that is a complex sentence, right? So there will be two subjects or rather phrases, right? Me, which is Siddharth, and my friend, right? There will be two subjects for that sentence, right? So that is the reason I claim that I find out the subject contenders, not the subject of the sentence.
Is this why you say that flattening the tree would be tough?
Yes, flattening the tree would be tough because the sentence syntax is not always straight, because you will not always say, I went to the school. You might say, let's say, cheese was eaten by a kid. It's not a direct sentence. The actual subject comes in the end, right? So, and it can have a complex structure also. Right now, we are supporting three different structures. One which we are supporting is the direct one, and the other which we are supporting is the inverted sentence, wherein the subject comes in the end. So food was eaten by the child. That's not the exact example because food is a subject. But there are some sentences which are inverted sentences, right? So for those sentences, the subject actually comes in the end. Along with that, I also take into account the subjects which are two. For example, me and my friend. So there are two subjects in the same sentence. So those are also taken care in the current solution. So after that, the next thing, identify the subject, which is Indian mothers. So how do I do that? It is one of the things that we discussed on the Chrome browser. Yes, somebody who said that. Who said that? Dependency. Yes, dependency. Who said that?
Too many people.
Okay, good. So thank you. So many people are awake. Okay, good. So identify the subject, which is Indian mothers, right? Okay. So actually, I was wrong. Sorry. That's the next step, this one. So identify subject is actually derived from the same constituency parser. How do I do that? For a direct sentence, if there are, let's say, I went to school, or Indian mothers. So if there are multiple subject contenders or phrase contenders, I look at the one which is on the left-hand side. It is easy to say on the left-hand side while speaking, but while coding, you have to, in the flattened binary tree, you have to find out the one with the lowest depth, which is on the top of the binary tree, that phrase. So that phrase is what I derive from the tree and call it as the subject, right? And then comes the subject contender. So there are two subject contenders from the sentence. One is mothers and one is Horlicks. As we saw on the sentence, where was the sentence? Yeah, so this is the sentence. And I remember seeing two N subjects here, or is it? Yeah, so you can see on top of Horlicks, the one which I am highlighting, it is subject. And mothers is also subject. Right? Okay. So there are two subjects. So that is why I have written identify subject contenders. Now then I do an intersection between subject contenders and the subject and I find out the final subject of the sentence. Right? That is what I'm trying to do here. It's almost, yes, please. For the yes, it can be. I said for the first category of sentence which we have taken care, we look at the left side. The first category of the sentence is wherein the subject is on the left side. For the passive sentence, we don't look at the left side. We look at the right side. The third. This thing identifies. I'll tell you how it identifies. So the question is, how do we identify something is a passive sentence and something is an active sentence, right? So how do we identify? We identify from this output. So this output tells you S on the top, right? If it's an inverted sentence, it will tell you S inverted. It will tell you S inverted. There will be an S inverted in front of it. So that is how we identify. From the parser, from the binary tree output itself, we try to identify. Right? Now the last concept here is lowest common hypernym. So everybody knows about WordNet, right? We all play with WordNet day in and day out. So there's a concept called as WordNet, called as lowest common hypernym. It is to say that if two things are related to each other, for example, a chef and a person are related because chef is also a person. Chef is also a person, right? A speaker is also a person. A cook is also a person. So chef and person, cook and person, they're all related. Right, so that is what I'm using in the end, lowest common hypernym, to identify if mother is a category of a person from WordNet. So in the end, what we identified that if the sentence, we found out the subject of the sentence, and we found out if the subject was related to a person or not. Right, so that was our aim before starting the algorithm. Right, now one question which should come into everybody's mind, because most of you might have heard about named entity recognition. How many of you have heard about or you have tried out? Almost everyone, right? So why didn't I use named entity recognition for the same task? I could have used NER to determine the person category, right? NER has that, right? So why didn't I use that? If somebody can answer, I think somebody would have realized why I didn't use it. Okay, so why I don't use it is because your NERs don't take care of these kind of plural nouns like children, person, chef. They only talk about, let's say, somebody's name or something really specific. Let's say, if I talk about, okay. So in not all the cases, it identifies that it is a person. So for example, if I say something like gardeners or something like children, it doesn't work. Maybe after this session, I can actually, if I have time, I can actually show that to the NLP code, which not the code base of the project, but I can actually run through some examples which will tell you why I have not used NER, because some of the things are not identified based on the NER. I'll show you some examples.
Yes.
Annotation as in?
For instance, spacing.
Yes.
It gives you an option to annotate certain entities.
Yes.
It comes with prepackaged entities. Like
yes.
You can identify location.
Yes.
Like that. But this high degree of context in the text that you're trying to annotate, you can annotate certain words.
Yes.
And then, use spacing to learn from those annotations.
Yes. So basically, annotation using the context-based embeddings. Correct.
Children.
Correct.
Correct.
We can.
Yeah.
We can actually manually annotate it, but we didn't get time to actually manually create some data set, so we went ahead with the complete unsupervised approach.
Got it.
So I'll move ahead to the next one. Yeah. Yeah, so some of the flows which are not so simple, or which are actually simple, wherein I don't need to really derive something from the sentence. I mean, I don't need to find out the sentence. So if I am not able to find out the sentence, because these techniques are not full flow. Constituency parser is not a full-fledged technique. It will have errors. So if I'm not able to identify it, I'll just go to the entire sentence. I'll find out the nouns or plural nouns. I'll feed them through the algorithm, which will find out if it can or if it is a person or not. So that is what this alternate flow is. It tells you if something, let's say, it is also easy to digest, allowing kids to consume it, right? So POS determined that kids is a plural and easy is a noun, plural noun and noun. So I fed that to the algorithm. From the WordNet lowest common hypernym, it identified kids as something which is a person, right? So this is an alternate flow. So scope for improvement, WordNet is not a end of the knowledge-based repository, right? So there are some words which are not defined in WordNet. This is an example of an inhaler product description which I got from a website. So this word pulmonologist is not there in WordNet. Then again, if you look at context, now coming to the context, even though BERT and all have context, if you look at WordNet, it also has context. Maybe we all have not looked at it because most of the things that we search with respect to the keyword context on Google turns out to be BERT or Elmo or Google sentence encoder. But actually, WordNet also has it. They're called as synsets. So there are missing contexts in WordNet. If you look at something called as synsets about WordNet, you'll find out that there are multiple contexts which are already there in WordNet. So using that, we found out that repairer is a word which doesn't have all the contexts in WordNet. Right? So these were the issues that we found out. Okay. So in between, maybe to keep everybody awake and to keep me also awake, let's discuss about some product descriptions which you feel are having to do with anything to do with person or senses. Let's or make up a sentence or something that you feel is related to senses. Anybody? From the back. I have explained, I've tried to explain in depth whatever I can. Now, some inputs I want from you also so that I know that there's something that you have understood from the session also. Till now. There's a lot more to come, but there's less time, but still let me just try to keep yourself awake and me awake as well. So anybody, anything that you feel, KFC, McDonald's, something that you remember on top of your head or a car or a gadget, which you feel was personal. Anybody? You can speak anything. I mean, that's fine. It can be wrong, it can be right. There's no hard and fast. You're not going to be penalized. Yes? Nobody? Sorry? Wholesome. Yes. Wholesome is something related to senses. Yes. It is related to senses and kind of benefits also, I think. Because something is wholesome. It's perfectly related to senses, for sure. And it is related to something that we eat, a wholesome meal. It is related to senses. Yes. So something that came out of the yummy. Somebody said yummy. So somebody is awake. Who is it? Okay. Yummy. So yummy is something related to senses, right? So next is what we explain about, what we want to talk about is a benefits related algorithm. So this algorithm is too long. I think I'll do the smaller one first so that everybody is awake and we can continue the session. So the smaller one is to do with the claims. So if you claim something, you have to speak about that claim in the advertisement as well, right? So the algorithm speaks about this sentence and tries to find out if there's a claim here. So it finds out a claim which is through the word best, right? So this is the same flow which has been given, right? You do use a POS tagger and try to find out if there is any superlative adjective or adverb used. Using POS tagging itself, you'll be able to find it out, right? And the superlative ones make it a claim. Now, claim can also be, which is something to do with a patent, right? So for example, I say that my Kindle reader is the most advanced. Now, why it is more advanced? It is not using any adjective or an adverb, but it still is a claim, right? For example, here. So if you see an example here, the second one, right? So this is an example from Amazon. So they have claimed that something is most advanced, an e-reader. So why it is most advanced, they have also given the steps or the reasons for that, right? So this is a good advertisement. And so let me go to the one which everybody knows and which everybody reads about, which is to do with the encodings, the embedded technologies which are popular nowadays, which is related to Elmo or Google Sentence Encoder, right? So we talked about senses, like yummy and other keywords, right? So we didn't find out a way to determine these. So then we chose BERT as our as our technology for finding these out. We also tried out Google Sentence Encoder, but we couldn't figure out our way to move around Google Sentence Encoder, and then we switched on to BERT for finding this, right? So how do I do that with BERT? So from two different sentences, what will BERT classify? Or what will a sentence encoder classify? So if I tell you this dish is looking yummy versus the lady is looking yummy, those are two different sentences with two different contexts, right? Or the dish is related to the dish, the lady is related to, I mean, the other sentence is related to a lady, how beautiful she is, right? So these are two different contexts. And BERT, how did we make sure that BERT actually identifies it? We created a manual corpus of all the senses. So if we have this keyword yummy, we actually wrote two different sentences with it. And then on top of that, we tried the BERT pre-trained model. We ran it on top of those two sentences. And then is where we found out, okay, which is the one which is related to the context. Let me give you an example to make it a bit clear. So this is an example. So for example, taste, right? So taste has many senses. So we actually went and created all the sentences out of the word taste. So taste can be in all, can be used in all these forms. Related to a dish, it could be related to resentment, a tone, a painful thing, cynicism, or difficult to bear. Right? And we wrote these sentences manually. We created a corpus of them. And then once you have a project description, you pass each and every sentence to BERT, and then you again pass these all sentences to BERT, and then try to find out which is the sentence which is most closest to the sentence that you've inputted. For example, if I say, the dish is amazing, the dish is delicious, I will feed it to the BERT model. Along with that, I will also feed this sentence. I will find out a relative score, which is, let's say, 0.45. And then I'll feed this sentence. Between this sentence and my dish is delicious, there will be a distance of, let's say, 0.7. So then, post that, I'll try to find out which is the one having the closest cosine similarity, not cosine similarity, the closest distance between those two sentences. And that is where I derive what is the context of the word which is used in the sentence. Right? Yes, please, if you have any questions on this. So this is BERT. Most of the people read about it, and most of the people have tried implementing it with either the pre-trained model or using their own corpus for generating a model. We used a pre-trained model on Wikipedia. Anybody who has anything to do or anything to say about this? You'll make me fall asleep as well, please. Yes. Sarcasm as a keyword for senses? In the, no. Yeah, so actually sarcasm we have not taken into account because we are only dealing with the product descriptions. But your sense is right, because if you review the sentences of the reviews, so let's say I'm writing a review about on Zomato or on Foodpanda, at that time, that thing will come into picture. The cynicism or the critical thing that has been written by somebody, right? So, but we have not taken care of those things because we, our content is not the reviews, our content is the product descriptions. Okay, so anybody who has any other thing to do with this thing? Okay. So to keep it sharp, since we have another 15 minutes left out, I'll move to the last category, which is to do with the benefits. Before I show you the results, what we achieved with this algorithm. Okay, guys, be seated. It's just 15 minutes left out, and I'll try to be quick. Okay. Something to do with the sentences. With the benefits related information about a sentence, right? So how do you deal with it? Hard to bite, which is then modern machinery which is used. So all these things are to do with the benefits of something, of the presentation, of the product which is there on the website, right? So here I picked up a whole a wheat based atta. I mean, it's a wheat flour that I picked up for this, right? Now, before going into this algorithm, there is a new technique that we use, which is called as OpenIE, open information extraction, right? So that is a new technique which you haven't, which you might not have tried out in most of your projects. So do you want me to explain to you that technique, or do you? It's a technique which is available in Stanford Core NLP parser. So if somebody wants to really get into that, I can explain to you, or else we can go ahead with the presentation. Anybody? You want me to go through the technique, or do you want me to quickly sharpen the presentation? Guys? Okay. So let me just quickly go to the technique. So I'll take the same example which is there. On the website. Okay. So the first technique which we used for this is called as coreference resolution. So all the sentences, if you have paragraphs, you'll have pronouns, right? A pronoun will refer to a noun. So how do we went about understanding how a pronoun has to be replaced with a noun in all these sentences, right? So we use something called as open information extraction for the second part of it and coreference resolution for the first part. One second, the coreference didn't seem to be coming up. Okay. See, so this is the output which I want you to concentrate, right? So all this is visual to you, but we actually coded all these outputs and flattened all these outputs to create something out of it, right? So this is the coreference resolution output. So what it tells you, there are two sentences, right? So the second sentence is use a word pronoun it. So it refers to which one? It says palm, which is incorrect. So coreference resolution is not a perfect technique. It has its own lags, and it is not perfect. So this is one of the techniques that we used. Again, there are challenges with this technique as well. It's not foolproof. It identifies something really bad as well sometimes. But yeah, I mean, this was the way out for using what is called as a pronoun replacement. So the next step that we used is OpenIE, Open Information Extraction. So open information extraction, so what it does, it basically tells you, it converts the entire sentence or a phrase into three different parts, subject, relation, and object, right? So if we look at this entire sentence, it is converting the output into multiple triplets of subject, relation, and object. So subject is whole wheat, is carefully grounded. This is one phrase that it identified. Then there are multiple other phrases which it identified. Right, so that's the technique called as open information extraction, which we used out of the Stanford Core NLP parser for this algorithm, which we created for the benefits related technique. Right. Yes. So anybody has anything to say on this?
Hi, Siddharth, I have a question for you. Hi.
Yes, sir.
So first of all, a very insightful presentation. So thanks for that.
Sure. Thank you. I hope I kept everybody awake. I tried. Yes.
So I see that you have been leveraging a lot of deep linguistic approaches, right?
Yes.
So a lot of things like parsers that you have been using, they're often trained on, I don't know, like a Wikipedia kind of corpuses or newsletter articles and things like this on a very well-formed sentences.
Yes.
So if you now try to apply this pre-trained parsing models and all these things on a kind of more of an informal language or maybe something like patents and things like this.
I didn't hear.
If you try to apply the pre-trained models,
pre-trained,
like a Stanford model,
correct,
on any different corpus, yes, which is not having a very cleanly made sentences, just take an example of a patent, social media, things like this.
Correct.
Do you see a need for retraining the dependency parser as such? Or do you really have to do something like this?
Okay, so what you're saying is there are pre-trained models, which is what you said the first. But you're saying if there is a need to really pre-train something like this,
just take an example of a Stanford parser, right? So Stanford parser, in my understanding, has been trained on, I don't know, like Wikipedia articles or based on the newsletter articles and all these things.
Yes.
If you now try to apply this model on patents or on social media, the language is significantly changing, the way people express, right?
Yes.
So there might be some difference or discrepancy in terms of how the post tags has been done, how the dependencies have been captured.
Correct.
So in these cases, do you see a need to retrain the parsers by yourself?
Yes, so what we're using is not something that has to be retrained again and again. It is something which is pre-built. If we have to retrain, I think the retraining should be coming into domain-specific things. For example, if some biotech company comes in, the keywords that they use, all these libraries don't have really any idea about what they're talking about. But generic words which they use and the generic syntax that they use, these are decently sufficient for us to do something. But where I feel that there's a need to retrain, I think domains is where. For example, if I get I'm saying biotech again and again because we got somebody who had a biotech product and they wanted to see their digital presence and then compare it with the other things in the market. So that is where I feel there is a need to retrain it really. But if you have to really retrain, you'll have to create a manual corpus, which is again a painful process. So creating a manual corpus is a painful process, right? That's a time-consuming activity which we really don't want to keep the customers waiting for a long duration to manually create the corpus, label it, and then train it. Because that's a painful part of all the training that comes in from the corpus that we manually create. Right? So that's what we wanted to skip here, because we didn't have that much time and scope to in the project to actually create a manual corpus. We did have some time, so that's where, and we didn't find out any other way to do things, so that's why we created a corpus for BERT. So you might have seen for the BERT, I was showing you that we have actually manually created the sentences for multiple senses. So for example, cold can be weather, cold can be person, cold can be a Vicks inhaler, right? So all these have to be separate contexts of the word cold. So there must be different sentences. If I have to create embeddings, I should have sentences for all these sentence encoders, right? And those sentences should be generic enough so that I can create a generic embedding out of that, right? So that is where we created a manual corpus, but that manual corpus only has about, I think, 90 words. So because it is manually created, and we have manually created almost like, for 90 words, we have created almost like 500 sentences. So that again has been created by our own team, and we have not actually gone to linguists and verify them, because what we see as sensory or a senses-related keyword might not be seen by a linguist as sensory-related keyword, right? And again, region to region, it changes. So something which is related to senses here, some people might be using that in a different context in, let's say, Britain, right? So that's the problem that we were facing here. So only for BERT, we created a manual corpus, again, which is limited as of now. As and when we are getting new stuff, we keep on enhancing it. But the problem that we are facing as of now is domain. So if somebody comes to us who is from a completely different domain, then we face a lot of challenge. We are not able to, the encoder itself drops off at this time. So we can get any domain. Some customer may come from let's say, agriculture domain. He'll ask us, I want you to check my product, let's say anything, my seeds, plant seeds. From plant seeds can be from multiple companies, like Namdhari is one company which gives you plant seeds, right? So the plant seeds can be from multiple companies. Now if they come to us and ask us that they want to really understand their presence, we are not able to do that as of today concretely, right? Because those are specific to a very typical domain, and we don't have that much sentences trained for those things, right? Yeah, so I hope I answered your question, sir. Yes.
Feel the US taggers are available for few domains, if I'm not wrong. So I think
correct.
The standard US tagger works on Wall Street journals predominantly.
Yes.
But I think there are few taggers which are available for medline journals or medline corpuses, which are
okay.
predominantly in medical domain.
Okay.
So what I feel maybe in your approach, mm-hmm. if you replace WordNet with mm-hmm. a domain-specific dictionary, which is going to tell you, let's say in a pharma domain, this is a drug, this is a medical condition or and
yes.
whatnot, then probably you don't have to change your linguistic model. Because in any case, in any domain,
yes.
a verb is going to remain verb. At
yes.
the same time, a proper noun is going to remain proper noun because it will
yes.
start with a first letter capital. So the linguistic
yes.
rules will remain the same.
Correct.
Probably what I feel, maybe you can change the knowledge base from WordNet to something like Medra for pharma. For banking, it could be different.
Correct.
So I think in that case, probably this approach can work.
You're actually right, because we looked at a corpus from legal tech company. They were providing a corpus, so you're actually right. This was a pain point for us, again, the domain. And we looked at other corpuses which were available. Then again, we have to really get them and really try them out. We didn't get time, but yes, that was something that we looked for a legal domain. Because somebody from a legal domain came to us and asked for something to do with how their thing was doing. But we don't support that because we know the model will not work well if you have a specific domain for which you won't find much
right.
in general public, what do you say, domains.
Okay.
You're right, actually.
Yeah. But in your case, who are the buyers for your solution? Is it
yeah.
chief marketing officer? Is it sales? Is it content curation? Or who is
you.
The actual buyer for this solution?
Yeah. So this product has been built for a marketing company. That marketing company has multiple customers. So those customers come to that company and ask that company that what is my digital presence in market compared to my competitors. So the same example I'll take again, MI. MI will come and ask what is my competition in market. This is the current project input, what I'm telling you. But yeah, it can be used in multiple areas. So when we do that, we also tell them the importance or the validity of their product description along with it. But the primary output should go to CPG companies, right? It should go to customer packaging companies, right? Because they put their products on all the websites. You have Colgate, right? Colgate comes on all the websites, right? But if you see the description of Colgate on each and every website, it will not be same. It will not be unique. For some of the things like iPhone, it might be unique. But if you look at something which is very, very much specific, for example, a diaper brand or a pen, let's say Parker is a pen, it will not be unique on all the websites because they don't have that much of budget to actually enhance and keep it steady, right? So that is where I think CPG companies are the actual consumers of this product. Yes.
Predominantly, this will further help, or probably visual merchandising is something which is coming up at a very faster pace.
In that case, it won't. It won't. So this is not. This will not help because you're not seeing any text, right? So the solution what we built apart from this, it looks at the image quality. It looks at the product title. Does it mention everything or not? It looks at whether all the things like specification, description, and all the things are mentioned or not. But you are right. In that case, it won't work.
And maybe this can help, as I see, based on the business needs, is that this can be predominantly helpful for designing campaigns. So how people are finding the connects. So you talk about senses.
Correct.
So are my customers connecting with the tagline, let's say chakki grinding or whatever?
Correct.
So are they really connecting? So campaign could be potentially a business where this is going to impact a lot.
Correct. I'll give you another example, which I think everybody will relate to, is the Obama campaign. When Obama won, they actually didn't put their tagline directly. They went ahead with two taglines. They did an A to B testing. So they actually put that tagline for two different variety of people. And actually, when they got an output, that is the tagline, they actually released it to public. So the tagline, if Obama had two taglines, I don't know what those taglines were, but I know the example. But if those taglines were something like, make America rich, and the other will be, we will bring our people together to make America rich. So the second one obviously has some keywords which brings the people in sense. So which has this content of the actual user or the actual people who are going to see that advertisement. So you're right. The same algorithm can be applied to the domain of campaigns as well. Yes. Sensory as well. I mean, because for the campaigns of something to do with the chocolate or panipuri, you'll have a tagline which is much more mouth watery, right? So that is where it would. Yeah, so the same algorithm can be tweaked and applied to those areas as well. You're right. Yes. You are perfectly right. I think this I should add somewhere so that I can highlight to other prospects. Yes. Somebody else has any other question? Yes. Yes.
Have to take that into account as well.
Yes, we have not taken
that. Yeah, so you can't just add best, cheesiest, all those sensory words. So you have to put that threshold in your algo as well, I guess.
No, best is not a sensory word. Best is a superlative word for a claim. So that we don't put in the corpus. That was identified by the PUS tagging. But yes, for sensory words.
Yeah, heartwarming,
So I don't know whether to what extent we can extend the corpus, but we didn't have any other approach and we had limited time at that time. So whatever we felt right, we just went ahead with it. Yeah. So anybody else has any other things to say? I can actually show you something in detail if you're trying to implement something similar for any other domain. I can actually show you how I did it in detail because I have my laptop here, so that doesn't matter. Yes. Anybody else has anything? Yeah, the flow chart, right? Oh, the flowchart, one more thing. Along with me and my presentation, the white paper also was quite late, so you will not see it in the booklet that is being given to you. So I don't know how it will reach you. That I think I will have. I have sent it to them a couple of days back. So the flowcharts are there, but I don't know how it will reach you. I will maybe check with them if they can just email everybody along with the presentation. Maybe along with the presentation, they can send you the white paper that has all the flowcharts. The flowcharts are pretty much straightforward. They don't tell you any technicality. The technicality is written in the white paper in detail. Yeah. Okay, so anything else? So one thing everybody missed is the accuracy that we found out with this algorithm, which nobody asked, which I think everybody should be asking.
So I have one question.
Yes, where are you? Sorry, where are you?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, sir.
So, how are you handling the quantitative description of the attributes? Like, if you talk about mobile, so there will be like this much of RAM, or this much of battery, and these kind of things. So, you haven't mentioned those kind of things because those are also important for the context.
They are important. They are features. As of now, have not quantified features. We are trying to quantify benefits. Benefits are different from features. Features are what it contains. Benefits is something that helps you personally. So, okay. For example, this is a lace. The material is lace. We have not clearly defined a boundary line on that. Mm-hmm. We are trying to do that. But yes, so we are trying to define a boundary line between a feature of a product and the, what do you say, benefit that a person derives from that product. For example, it is made up of cotton, is a feature. It helps you feel easy in summers, is a benefit.
So suppose like I am looking for cotton and I am saying like two layers of cotton in this shirt and that might be important me for as a personally.
That is an important thing.
So
that is an important
we should be considering those quantitative descriptions as well.
Yes, we should be. As of now, we are not able to personally when we are trying to tag the sentences. So we have for getting the accuracy, we have tagged 100 sentences personally.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So, but we are not able to define the boundary line as to what is feature, what is a description. That boundary line, even we are not able to achieve it at higher accuracy as of now. We are trying to go towards benefits and all. But as you said, features are important and they have to be placed in the algorithm. But as of now, we have not placed them.
Thank
but
you.
They are important. Yes. Yes. Okay. Thank you, guys. So this is the accuracy, as you can see on the screen. The 72% accuracy is on a labeled data set of 100 descriptions. The first that you see, like 1,336, all those were coming from the solution. We didn't label it manually. So that was for unsupervised. For supervised, we manually labeled the data set based on our understanding, and we just did 100 descriptions. And this is the accuracy that we got for that. Thank you. Thank you so much.